if you open your Bibles up to the book of Acts, chapter 26, verse 14. The book of Acts, chapter 26, verse 14. And if you can, if you stand to your feet for the reading of God's word. Again, Acts chapter 26, verse 14. And I'll be reading from the NIV version. It'll be on the screen. And it reads, "We all fell to the ground, and I heard a voice saying to me in Aramaic, 'Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads.' We all fell to the ground, and I heard a voice saying to me in Aramaic, 'Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads.'" You may be seated in the presence of God. I tell this story often about me. I didn't grow up in church. And I remember one time I attended this church and I went down for the altar call. I'd never forget. And the man of God was praying for everybody and he was giving a prophetic word. And he stood and he looked at me. And he said, "Young man, you are going to be rich." And I said, "Yes." Yes, I'm getting to the money. I'm getting to the cash, the lettuce, the relish, whatever you call your money, the bread. I'm going to be rich. I'm looking back at the people in line. Did y'all hear this man? He said, "I'm going to be rich." And he said, "Yes, young man, you are going to be rich, rich in spirit." And I said, "Man, come on now. I don't really want the spirit stuff. God, just give me the money. You can keep the spirit. I don't want to be rich in spirit." I remember leaving church that day, sad. And now that I'm older, I can relate to the young rich ruler. The Bible says that he showed up to Jesus and he said, "Jesus, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said, "Of course, you got to start following the commandments." He started rattling them off. "Do not commit adultery. Do not be a murderer." Young rich ruler said, "Man, I've been doing all that since I was a boy. I got it sold up." And then Jesus said, "But it's one thing that you lack." He says, "Go sell everything that you have and give it to the poor." And the Bible says that the young man's face dropped because he was really wealthy and that he walked away sad. What do you do? What do we do when God tells us what we don't want to hear? What do you do when God tells you what you don't want to hear? If you give me a few minutes, actually, I'd like to preach a message titled, "Kicking It." Kicking it. Most people just kick it. They walk away from it when God tells them something that they really don't want to hear. See, the word "kicking it" is twofold. Kicking it can mean to propel, to drive, to send, but it also means to get out, to quit, to do without, to give up. That's why you hear a lot of people when they're addicted, they say, "Man, I'm trying to kick this habit." That means I'm trying to quit this habit. I'm trying to stop doing this habit. See, I always knew that I was going to be rich. No, I always knew I was going to be rich. I just didn't know it would be rich in spirit. The Apostle Paul in this text, he already knew. He always knew that he was going to preach. God has called him to preach, but he didn't know it was going to be in prison. So you have to understand, he was in prison for 2 years, falsely accused. But here Paul is, he's in prison and he's kicking it. And he finally gets a trial day. He finally has his day in court. And in his text, he is telling his testimony. He is telling his story. Paul is in prison telling his testimony. That's why I always tell you, I'm so big on people telling their testimony when they're going through it and not waiting to after. You can't wait to after that you think it's over to tell your testimony, because you don't know how long you're going to be here. You don't know how long it's going to last. You have to tell it during. Testimony is all about escaping your feelings. Most people don't want to share their story because it's going to hurt their feelings. They don't want to remember their past. They don't remember the things that they used to do or the things that they currently do. So most people sit on their testimony, but your testimony is about escaping your feelings, and you have to be willing. You have to be willing. See, Paul was accused of three things. He was caused because they said he was causing too much disruption amongst the Jews. They labeled him a renegade. They labeled him a renegade, and then they went on to say that he was the ringleader of a religious cult, one that they didn't recognize, so it went against Roman law. And then they say he disrespected the temple. The issue was they had no proof. They had no proof. So Paul is telling them in trial, he says, y'all accuse me of these three things. He says, y'all accuse me of disrupting the Jews in a lot of these different places. But he says, I know those people in those places. He says, and if you would just go to them, he said, if they are willing to testify, then you will find out the truth. But the Roman agent who was representing Rome in the court, his name was Felix. He didn't want any problems with the Jews. So you got to understand, at that time, the Jews, it was a lot of them. They dominated the majority. And Felix was a Roman. So in order to keep peace between the Jews and the Romans, he wanted to do whatever the Jews favored. And the Jews were secretly trying to kill Paul. So instead, what Felix did, he's like, look, even though I know this man might be innocent, I'm going to keep him in jail because I want to keep the peace. He literally kept Paul in jail for a whole 2 years until he left on good terms. And then when he leaves, another person, another agent comes and takes his place by the name of Festus. And Festus, who was just, who was a little more righteous than Felix, he finally gives Paul this trial. And that's what we pick up in this text. Paul is on trial and he's giving him his testimony. And Paul says, yes, I was killing Christians. Paul says, I was killing Christians, he said, because I conformed to the strictest religion in my country. He said, so yes, I was killing Christians. He said, and I became a Pharisee. The Bible says, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but you got to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That's why religion can be a pattern of this world. No, religion can be a pattern of this world. I'll never forget when you're reading the Bible, the Pharisees, they come to the disciples and they ask them, why do y'all not fast? Why do y'all not fast like John the Baptist's disciples? And if you know, the whole purpose of fasting is to get close to Jesus. That is the whole purpose of fasting, is to get close to Jesus. The disciples are literally sitting next to Jesus eating. And these people come and say, why are y'all not fasting like John the Baptist? The purpose of fasting is to get close to Jesus. They're sitting next to Jesus, so there is no purpose. There is no purpose. There is no reason for them to fast. But because of what they're used to, they miss them. Because of what they used to, they miss them. See, you can be so caught up in tradition. You can be so caught up in religion. You can be so caught up in a pattern that you miss his presence. You can be so caught up in a pattern that you miss his presence. See, you can have good intentions and really be doing wrong. No, you can have good. You can have great intentions and be doing wrong. That's why the Bible says, do not let your good be spoken evil of. No, do not let your good be spoken evil of. I never forget when I was first dating my wife. She was staying up here in the Dallas area, and I was living in Houston. And I had a homegirl who wanted to go to church. So I said, man, come to my church. And I told my wife, or my girlfriend at the time, now, I knew a little better. I'm like, no, I'm not going to pick this girl up. She can't ride with me. But she can meet me at the church. We got to church and we sat together. I'll never forget. Everybody kept coming up to me. Man, that ain't your girlfriend. We know your girlfriend. Your girlfriend came to Houston before. She done been to this church before. Getting dirty looks. And all of a sudden, I start to feel uncomfortable. And I remember leaving that day and God says, do not let your good be spoken evil of. He says, your intentions were good. He said, but the way, the perception of what it looks, not only have you embarrassed yourself, but you've also discouraged others because people are looking at you. And they don't know the story of why this girl is sitting next to you. All they know is 1 minute last service you had this girlfriend, and now you're in another service next week and you got another one. He says, let this be a lesson. Do not let your good be spoken evil of. I don't talk to her no more. Not because of that reason, but I don't talk to her no more. Paul says, I too was convinced. He says, I was convinced that I was doing the right thing, and at every corner I went against Jesus. He said, every corner I tried to oppose Jesus of Nazareth, but then Paul has an encounter with Jesus. Saul, why are you persecuting me? I love Jesus because he asks him a question, why are you persecuting me? And then he tells him what it is. He says, it is hard to kick against the goads. kick against the goals. That means it's pointless to kick against the goals. That means you're only hurting yourself. So you have to understand what a goal is. A goal is a farm tool that has a sharp, sharp end. And what happens is the goals, they were used to keep a stubborn ox going forward. So many times, because the ox was so stubborn, he would kick back against the goal. And he would do more harm than good, because when you kick back against that sharp point, it would start to tear off their flesh. It would start to tear off their flesh. So a lot of people think that this encounter, it just happened suddenly with Christ. But based off what God has told Paul, he says, why are you kicking against the goats? It lets you know that he was after Paul for a long, long, long time. That he had been ministering to Paul. He had been calling him. Most of the time, God has been calling us for a while. If anybody can testify, God has been calling us for years. God first called me when I was 15. I'll never forget. I was 15 in high school. I heard God speak to me. I heard what he told me to do. And I'm too young. Are you crazy? You asking me to do this? I'm still drinking Similac. I'm still wet behind the ears. You want me to do what? Now I'm good on that. Then it was 3 years later, getting ready to graduate high school, about to go off to SFA. At that time, SFA, the initial stood for sex, fun, and alcohol. I'm about to go down there and have the time of my life, and God speaks to me again. Are you crazy? I'm going to SFA, and you want me to live what type of life? Nah. I kick back against it. I kick back against it. I kick back against it. Even to this day, 20 years later, after being 15, I'm 35 now. I'm saved, but I will still kick back against the word of God. I know God has called me to preach. I know God has called me a pastor, but because of what comes with it. I see how people treat pastors. I see how they talk about them. And I don't want the responsibility. I don't want the accountability that comes with it. But your kicking is not in vain if you're kicking for the right reasons. Your kicking is not in vain if you're kicking for the right reasons. Your kicking only becomes in vain if you're kicking in the wrong direction. If you kick backwards, you're always going to hurt yourself. Nobody kicks a field goal backwards in the opposite direction. When you're playing soccer, you don't kick it in your goal. You're only hurting yourself. But if you kick it in the right direction, if you kick it for the right reasons, then there's nothing wrong with kicking it. But you got to kick it for the right reasons. A lot of people like hanging with their homeboys, their homegirls. They like kicking it. I like kicking it too. But God had to teach me a very valuable lesson. You have to be kicking it for the right reasons. I had a homeboy. We were best friends since middle school. Best friends since middle school. We grew apart. We went our separate ways. No big fallout. I'm married with kids. He's single. He don't have no kids. We live two totally different lifestyles. But I find myself, man, that's my partner. I'm going to pull up on him. I forced my way to go kick it with him one time. He was rapping, so this was a couple of years ago. He was a rapper, so he said, I'm at this studio, I think, in Grapevine. I literally drove 50 minutes all to stay but 5 minutes. I drove 50 minutes. I'm thinking it's a legit studio. It was a studio in an apartment, but I ain't judging. That's cool. I go in there anyway. The place is smoked out. There's about 20 dudes in there. You drank. I don't drink. You smoke? Nah, I'm good. I'm just sitting there, and he's in the booth rapping. He come out, shake my hand, and I'll be right with you. He rapping. I got so uncomfortable that I got up and left. Drove 50 minutes to sit for 5 minutes. There's nothing wrong with kicking it, but you got to be kicking it for the right reason. Jesus wasn't just kicking it for the sake of kicking it. A lot of people say that Jesus, he ate with sinners. He ate with tax collectors. No, if you read the Bible says that they came and they ate with him. They ate with him because they liked how he was kicking it. They liked how he was kicking it. You can't just kick it for the sake of kicking it. Again, there's nothing wrong with hanging out. There's nothing wrong with hanging out, but you have to realize that most people are only trying to hang in there. Most people are only trying to hang on. Anytime you allow people in the crowd to hang on to you, you're always going to fall. Anytime you allow people in a crowd to hang on to you, you're always going to fall. Why? Because it is so easy to trip. It is so easy to stumble when you're in a crowd. The Bible says when we had fallen, most people fall in a crowd. And I know you like kicking it in the crowd. Trust me. I used to be one. I loved kicking it in the crowd. But you have to watch who you surround yourself with. The Bible says that the gates of hell, it's enlarged. That means that thing is wide. Why? Because it's designed for crowds, but the one to heaven, that thing is narrow. Why? Because it comes with responsibility. It comes to with accountability. In Romans, God says, don't become a stumbling block or a hindrance. Don't become a stumbling block or a hindrance. That gate to heaven is narrow because you are held accountable. That means you can't go off what grandma do. No, you can't go off what mama do, what your brother do. You can't be going off what somebody else do. Again, according to your faith. According to your faith, not someone else's. People ask me to pray for them all the time. The first question I normally ask them, have you prayed for yourself? Have you prayed for yourself? Because, see, I used to be praying for people, praying for people, praying for people, praying for people. I wanted better than them. And God finally tells me, you can pray till you blue in the face. I'm not going to move because they don't want it. It's according to their faith, not yours. So according to your faith, that's what the problem was with the seven sons of Sceva. You hear the story all the time. They're trying to cast a demon out of a man, but they're trying to do it in the name of that Paul proclaims. They went and said, we're trying to cast this demon in the one that Paul preaches about. But who you preach about? Who you preach about? So when the demon rises up and he stands bold and he tells them, okay, look here. Jesus, I know. Paul, I know about. But who are you? I don't know you. And because he didn't know him, the Bible says that the man rose up and he beat them naked and ran them out of the city. Where is your faith there? No. Where is your faith at? The Bible says that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And everyone will have an opportunity to know this word. Everyone is going to have an opportunity to know this word. God says heaven and hell, they're going to pass away. He says, but this word, he said, this word, this is going to stand. This word is going to last forever. Everyone is going to have the opportunity to know Jesus. You have to understand Jesus and the word are synonymous. Jesus and the word are synonymous. That's why it says Jesus was the word made flesh. He is the word made flesh. That's why sometimes you might not know any scripture. But if you just call on the name of Jesus, you said every scripture, every line that you've ever needed. Jesus is the word made flesh. So everybody will have an opportunity to know this word. Everybody will have an opportunity to know Jesus. The Bible says in the beginning was the word and the word was with God. And Paul is testifying. He says, and when we had fallen, when we had fallen, when we had fallen, when all of us had fallen. That blessed me just reading that. When all of us had fallen, that lets you know that God wants all of you. God wants all of you. He doesn't operate on a partial basis. He specializes in wholeness. See, a lot of people, they start following Christ, and they only give them a part of them. They get saved, they confess Christ, but they only give them a part of them because they think the other part is too dirty. They think the other part is too filthy. They think it's not good enough. It's too dirty. But the truth is, we're made from dirt, so of course you're going to have some dirty ways. You made from dirt, so of course dirt is going to be in your human nature. But through Christ, dirty things become clean. Through Christ, dirty things become clean. Your difference is what makes you significant. Your difference is what makes you significant. Paul was a Jew and a Roman citizen. They don't even go together. They don't even go together, but his difference is what makes you significant. The Bible says that we're going to be persecuted for his name's sake. Paul was killing Christians. Believers were being persecuted for God's name's sake. Then he turns around and becomes a Christian, and he starts becoming persecuted. But blessings come with persecution. I promise you, blessings come with persecution. They go hand in hand. A lot of people want blessings, but they can't handle the persecution. Blessings and persecution go hand in hand. The Bible said, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Then it goes on to say, blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Blessed is not a feeling. Being talked about don't feel good. Even if I am ugly, you better not tell me I'm ugly. That don't feel good. I'll never forget, we was in church one time. And this lady, I don't know what she had against me. But she was looking at my wife. She kept saying, ooh, you are so pretty. You are so beautiful. Ooh, and then she come back. You are so beautiful. You are so beautiful. You are so pretty. And I'm looking there, and then she said, Hit me with a sound effect. They didn't even say nothing. Just, Look me up and down, you are so lucky to have her. I said, man, I appreciate you. You know, she is beautiful. I am lucky to have her. No, you're blessed to have her. I said, I get it, ma'am. I get it. Calm down. I am blessed to have her. And I'm like, man, I know I'm not a pretty boy, but I ain't ugly. Now, I know I'm not ugly, but this when it hit me, I can't depend on people's opinions. I can't depend on opinions. I can't lean on likes because the word of God stands all on its own. Again, heaven and hell will pass away, but this word is going to stand forever. The word of God stands on its own. That's the issue. That's the thing the woman at the well had to learn. The word of God stands all on its own. Jesus came to her and she kicked back against the word. She kicked back against the word. He says, give me something to drink. She says, I'm a Samaritan. You a Jew. I don't even fool with your kind. We don't even fool with each other. And Jesus had to tell her, if you knew who you was talking to, if you really knew who you was talking to, you would ask me for water because I give living water. And she looked at him. She says, you give living water. She said, but you don't even have nothing to draw with. She said, and this well runs deep. And he says, the water that I give, though. He says, the water in this well, he said, people drink this and become thirsty again. But the water that I give, you will never thirst again. Then the woman said, well, where is this water at? She says, give it to me. Give me this water. And he tells her, go get your husband and come back. Go get your husband and come back. She said, I ain't got no husband. He said, I know. He said, you done had five of them. And the one that you with right now, it is not your husband. It is not your husband. The truth shall set you free. See, just because you kick against the word and disregard it does not mean it's not true. Just because you try to disregard the word does not mean it's not true. The word is true. And whatever God speaks, that's what's going to happen. That's what's going to happen. It does not matter who you are. Moses was one of the most faithful servants. The people were complaining, saying they were thirsty. He goes up to God. God tells him what to do. God says, okay, they are thirsty. I want you, it's going to be this rock right here. I want you to speak to the rock. When you speak to the rock, water is going to come out. Moses goes back down, getting ready to give water to the people, but he's so frustrated at them because he's leading them, and they continue to talk down. They continue to complain. So instead of speaking to the rock, Moses hits the rock with his staff. He hits the rock, and water comes out, and the people, they drink the water. But then God pulls Moses to the side. Come here. Let me holler at you. I told you to speak to the rock, not hit it. And because you hit it, and then speak to it, because you didn't obey my word, he says that you're going to see the promised land, but you're not going to enter it. You're going to see the promised land, but you're not going to enter it. And I'm sure Moses, because it's in our human nature, probably tried to do like my kids do when I tell them something. Matter of fact, I think it was just 2 days ago, my kids were in the car acting a fool. I said, when we get home. I'm telling you right now, when we get home, I am going to whoop you. You better know. And then all of a sudden, they act like they sleep in the car. Got home. I did not see these kids. I go upstairs, both of them in the bed. So I'm sure that's what Moses did. Now, God said, I'm not going to see the promised land. But if I'm just on my best behavior, they did all that. He went. He saw the promised land. He probably thought he was going to get in. He could see the promised land. And the Bible says that he died. Because God's word, at the end of the day, don't matter who it is, that word is true. That word is true. You can't doubt that word. Sarah laughed at God. She laughed at the man of God and said, Sarah, look here, you are going to be pregnant. You are going to have a son. The Bible says that she laughed to herself. And God didn't even speak to Sarah. He spoke to Abraham and said, why is she laughing? No, why is she laughing? See, because Sarah wasn't even on his level, so he couldn't speak to her. No, why is she laughing? And because she was afraid at that point, I didn't laugh. He said, yes, you did. He says, yes, you did. Her thoughts were not level. See, because of her old age, she thought she couldn't experience a new birth. Because of her old age, she thought she couldn't experience a new birth. God will always humble you. God will always humble you. That's why it says when we had all fallen to earth. When we all fall into earth, God will always bring you back down to earth because the word says you shouldn't think more highly of yourself than you ought to. Doesn't mean you shouldn't think high of yourself, but you shouldn't think more highly of yourself than you ought to. That's the story of the Tower of Babel. That's really what that story is all about. The people were gathered there and they decided, you know what, we're going to build a tower up to heaven. That's what we gonna do. Everything going good on earth, but they just decided, because see, people are smart. People are curious. They'll get into stuff. You know what? We just gonna build a tower up to heaven. We're gonna go up there and see what that's like. And I can imagine that God is looking down at them, like, what are they doing? Now, this is what we're gonna do. Because they're all on one accord. They all speak the same language. We just gonna make them speak different languages. So therefore they can't understand each other, and we're gonna knock this tower down. And that's exactly what he did. He will always bring you back down to earth, because he gives us the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And he tells us whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Whatever you bind on earth and whatever you loose on earth. So your job is to operate on earth, not in heaven. We're going to get to that part on the other side, but your job is to handle business on the earth. Paul says, I heard a voice speaking to me. I heard a voice speaking to me. After we had fallen, then it immediately says, I heard a voice speaking to me. See, if you place yourself above God, God don't even speak to you. Because, see, when you're up so high, you don't even listen. God could be trying to speak to you. You don't even hear God. It's always easy to hear people that's on the top of the mountain. But people on the bottom of the mountain, when they shout up, the people up there, they can't hear them. But if the person's on top of the mountain, they start yelling down, everybody can hear them. There are levels to this. You have to understand there are really levels to this. I love people, and I especially love my black people. They always walking around talking about, man, we are queens and kings. Boy, we kings. All my homeboys tell say, hey, good morning, king. Good night, king. And I be laughing to myself. We are kings, but we can't forget that there is a king of kings. No, they let you know that there's levels. Says we are the king of kings. God is never going to speak to you on his level, because we're not on his level. That's why the Bible says God always comes and he meets us where we're at. We don't meet him where he at. He always comes and meets us where he's at. He's never going to speak to you on his level, because we're not on his level. That's why with many people, if you read the Bible, they came to listen to Jesus. They sat at his feet. They always sat at his feet. They sat at the feet of Jesus, because there's levels to this. John the Baptist said, this is a man right here. He says his sandals, his shoes, I'm unworthy to even tie. Every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. We are not gods. A lot of people walk around talking, man, I'm a god. I'm like, no, the Bible says that we're made in his image and likeness. So that means we are like God, but we are not a god. I never forgot when I was in physical therapy school, we got to watch a couple of surgeries. And we was watching this surgeon. And the surgeon stood up and he was talking about how he felt like he was playing God, because he was having the ability to save people's lives. He said he felt like he was playing God. I never forget, then a year later, he kicked the can. I guess God was not playing. A year later, he kicks the can. I guess God was not playing, because we are not God. And God is not playing with us. Saul, why do you persecute me? Why do you kick against this word? Why do you go against this word? God tells Jonah to go to Nineveh, he go to Tarshish. God told him, go to Nineveh, he goes to Tarshish. Get on these people's boat. And because he on there, because he's being disobedient, storm hitting the boat, stuff rattling, stuff going all wrong, and they trying to figure out what is going on. Then finally he admit, hey, it's me. Hey, we love you. They throw him off the boat. You got to get up out of here. A big whale swallows him. That's the story of Jonah in the belly of the whale. He making it hard for everyone else because of his disobedience. I always tell people, you have to see the bigger picture. It's never about you. It's never been about you. It's about others and your disobedience. Your disobedience can lead to the whole family disobedience. I know in my family, if I don't line up, if the head is not right, the whole family suffers. The whole family suffers. You cannot be hard-headed. You can't be hard on everyone else. That's why I sympathize with Cain. That is why I sympathize with Cain. Cain was the first murderer in the Bible. It says that he killed his brother Abel. But I always say, if you really look at Cain, his story, you will find out that he was given an impossible task. because of his parents, because of what his family did, because of what the people in his lineage did. Adam and Eve, of course, you know the story. They ate from the tree. God told them, you can eat from any tree. You can have anything in here. Do not touch this tree. And they touched the tree anyway. And the Bible says that they were cursed. And one of them curses was they were going to have to work the ground, especially for Adam. He would have to work the ground, the sweat of his brow, the rest of his life. So then when Cain and Abel come, Abel is tending to the flock, but they tell Cain, your job is to work the ground. How am I working a ground that's already cursed? This is impossible. I'm working a ground that's already cursed. You've given me an impossible task. You've given me an impossible task. And he gets frustrated. He gets frustrated, and as a result, he kills his brother because God accepted Abel's offering. All he commanded was the first fruit. Abel gave God his best. And what Cain was doing, Cain was still bringing him his fruit, but he was bringing them the last. And he ended up killing Abel. But God speaks to Cain. He tells him, but if you do what is right, he says, if you do what is right, he says, will I not accept yours as well? Will I not accept yours as well? See, when you kick against the goad, you're only hurting yourself. You're only hurting yourself. And I always ask people, all that kicking, you not tired yet? Are you not tired? Are you not hurt enough? You ain't kicked enough yet? Kicking the goal, kicking the goal, kicking the goal only leads to being at rock bottom. But sometimes rock bottom is a great place to be. Because when you're rock bottom, that means there's only one place to go. There's only one direction to go, and that's up. It's only one direction to go, and that's up. If you read the story, God ends up telling. He ends up telling Paul after he had fallen, and he asked him, why do you persecute me? It's hard to kick against the goads. He then tells him to get up. Get up and stand up on your feet. He says, I've anointed you. I've appointed you a servant and a witness. So you can go and you can testify of my goodness. Testify of what you see and what you're about to see. He says, testify of my light in darkness. He said, I want you to let them know, strip the power from Satan and let them know that God runs this place. He said, so that they may be forgiven of their sins. Why do you persecute me? Saul later turned Paul. Jesus asked him, why do you persecute me? You can replace Paul's name and put your name there. No, Femi, why do you persecute me? Karen, no, why do you persecute me? Tiffany, why do you persecute me? Will, why do you persecute me? Why do you kick against me? Why do you kick against the word that I gave you? God has already given you a word. He's already told you what it's going to be, but yet and still, because of what it looks like, because we don't feel it, because we don't see it, we still will kick against the word. And God says, you're only hurting yourself. You're only hurting yourself. He says, but when you're sick and tired, when you really get sick and tired, and if you really want to change, he said, here I am. He said, I stand at the door, he says, and I knock. He says, I won't kick the door down. He says, I'm not going to kick the door down. He said, but I will continue to knock at the door of your heart until you open up and you let me in. He says, I want to sup with you if you will have me as your dinner guest. Why do you kick against the goads? Again, there's nothing wrong with kicking it. You just got to make sure you're kicking it in the right direction. Have dedicated my life trying the best of my ability that I'm going to kick it in the right direction. Is it easy? No. Is it worth it? Yes. My wife will tell you I will go against family, I will go against friends in order to kick this gospel because I know that it is needed. I know that I know that I know that I know that I know it's needed. I can't tell you how many times I want to turn and walk away. Matter of fact, just yesterday, I wanted to be watching college football like everyone else. Today, I'll be wanting to watch the NFL games. But God was dealing with me. He says, no, I need you to study more. He says, I need you to spend time with me. I'm like, but everybody's watching the games. God, I want to watch the games too. He says, you can go and kick it. But if you kick it in the right direction, he says, if you do what I'm calling you to do, he says, I promise you, you'll be able to watch the games one day. You'll be able to watch the games one day. He said, but it's bigger than you. This is for the next generation. It's for the generation that's already here. This is for your kids' kids. He says, I'm trying to do something in the earth. Many are called, few are chosen. Many are called, few are chosen. He says, I call a lot of people. I call a lot of people. I call a lot of people. Half of them don't answer. The other half, they don't stay on the phone long. Some of them stay on the phone, but they just put me on mute. He says, but the day that you hear my voice, he say, harden not your heart. Harden not your heart. Don't kick against the goads. If you're going to kick it, you better be kicking it for Jesus.